You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at mixlr.com/options-insider. That's mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at twitter.com/options, stocktwits.com/options, facebook.com/theoptionsinsider, or via questions at theoptionsinsider.com. The Options Insider Radio Network is sponsored by Fidelity Investments. Fidelity's Option Trade Builder tool can help you confidently build an options trade in three simple steps. Just choose a strategy, select a contract, and then review the benefits and risks of the trade. Learn more about Option Trade Builder at fidelity.com/options. Options trading entails significant risk and is not appropriate for all investors. Certain complex option strategies carry additional risk. Before trading options, contact Fidelity Investments by calling 800-544-5115 to receive a copy of the characteristics and risks of standardized options. Fidelity Brokerage Services, LLC, member NYSE SIPC. Bitcoin, Ether, Ripple, Litecoin, and more. Cryptocurrencies and other digital assets are taking the financial world by storm. This exploding market provides everything a savvy trader needs: volatility, volume, and liquidity, provided you know how to find it. That's where we come in. Welcome to the Crypto Rundown. Each week, we'll break down the latest trading activity, trends, and developments on everything from coins to tokens, futures, and even OTC options. If it's moving the crypto markets, then you'll find it on the Crypto Rundown. Now it's time to dive into the exploding world of cryptocurrencies and digital assets. It's time for the Crypto Rundown.
Everybody, that music means it is time once again for the Crypto Rundown, the program where we break down everything going on the other side of the fence. So not our typical usual equity index or futures options, but no, what's going on in the world of crypto? That could be spot, that could be the options, that could be the futures, that could be everything going on in between. My name is Mark Longo from theoptionsinsider.com, as well as, of course, from the ever exciting The Options Insider Radio Network. We have a lot to get to on today's show and a great guest to help us do it. So without further ado, let's keep on rolling right on into the crypto hot seat.
Forget about cold storage. It's time to turn up the heat on thought leaders from the world of cryptocurrencies and digital assets. It's time to take their place on the crypto hot seat.
All right, everybody, welcome to the Crypto Hot Seat, the portion of the show where we welcome on guests from throughout the world of crypto and indeed beyond and proceed to pick their brains for the benefit of you, the listener. And next up in the old hot seat is a newcomer to the program and indeed to the network. She is Juthika Chow, the COO and co-founder over there at Ledger X. Juthika, welcome to the Crypto Rundown program.
Thank you for having me.
And Juthika, as we are wont to do with all of our first-timers here on the network, why don't you go ahead and give our audience a little bit of an overview of your background in the financial space and how you found your way to co-founding Ledger X?
Sure. So I come from an options background, so I love what you guys do. I traded for 7 years at Goldman Sachs. I started with equity options on the high-frequency options market-making side, and then I built out our VIX business, trading VIX and VIX options. And finally, after 5 years of that, I moved over to our franchise desk where I traded dispersion and correlation, which again, it's basically just equity options. And so I've always come from an options background. I like options for a number of reasons. And when our CEO and my husband, Paul, and I got interested in Bitcoin many years ago, there were a lot of natural analogs, and it was almost natural for us to start a derivatives platform that focused on Bitcoin options, which is what Ledger X is.
You're not the first person I've heard say something similar. Obviously, here in Chicago, there's a pretty deep bench of options expertise. I know quite a few experienced old school options hands who've made the allusion to me many times that what they're seeing right now in the Bitcoin and indeed the crypto space is very much analogous to what they used to see back in the early days, the late 70s, early 80s, out in places like the SIBO, when it was still kind of the Wild West for options. Crypto very much in that same category right now. Still kind of the Wild West. Still there's opportunities there, but it hasn't quite been regulated or squeezed to death. There's volume, there's volatility. That's all a professional a trader needs to really get going in these types of markets. But I'm curious, Juthika, we've had a lot of people come on the show with backgrounds like yours, coming from the traditional financial world into the world of crypto. And usually for them, there's some moment, there's some inflection point, come to Jesus moment, call it what you will, something that lured them away from traditional finance and into the dark side of crypto. I'm curious, what was that moment for you?
So for me, it was back in 2011, summer of 2011, when I was still working at Goldman and had gotten introduced to Bitcoin through Paul was on the West Coast at the time, and I think it had its first mini price spike. And so we took an interest in it philosophically from a, you know, having lived through 2008 at Goldman from a financial and technological point of view. But I think really the turning point was when we went through the process to actually try to acquire some and play with it. And so it took us many weeks to actually get, you know, a dollar worth of Bitcoin, because it had to go through Goldman compliance. And then we had to move our funds from Goldman to, at the time, Mt. Gox. And it was a process that caused incredible headaches. But once we finally got our hands on Bitcoin, we could just send it back and forth across coast 24/7, 365, without any intermediaries. And so it became very evident that it was creating something that was not possible before. I think it did take me years to still develop the appreciation that I have for it now, but that was at least the point when I think something clicked that, hey, this is different from anything else that exists. And we started drawing the parallels to gold and things like that.
There you go. That was it. And you were off to the races. Well, you guys certainly have been fairly active of late, I think, to put it mildly. We'll get to all that in a second. But I think it's fair to say there might still be a cadre of our audience out there, particularly those maybe on the retail side, who aren't particularly familiar with Ledger X. Give them a quick 10,000-foot overview. What is Ledger X? What can I trade when I go there?
Ledger X is a U.S. federally regulated derivatives platform, which really for the retail investors just means it's regulated in the same way that you're trading any other commodity option. We're regulated by the CFTC. We are the only platform for physically settled Bitcoin options. And so what that means is you can send Bitcoin, but you can send dollars. You can buy a call option and, you know, let's say it's a 20,000 strike call option. If it ends in the money, you actually receive Bitcoin. And so that bridge, we think, is really important. It's really important for our retail and institutional customers. And we offer a whole range of options. So we have the terms go out to December 2020, and the strikes go up to 100,000. And we have people trading, even over this weekend, trading the 50,000 strike in June, the 50,000, 100,000 strikes in December 2020. And so we offer a wide range of vanilla puts and calls that are, quote-unquote, physically settled to Bitcoin.
That's fantastic. You know, we get questions every week, and we've had a lot of guests on this program over the course of this, close to this past year now, who have all sorts of interesting offerings on the crypto derivative side of the fence, but for regulatory reasons, most of them are not available here to clients in the U.S. Usually it's some sort of maybe a warrant that's available in Europe or something that's only available in Asia or Australia or other, shall we say, more crypto-friendly regulatory environments as opposed to not here in the U.S. But you guys, Ledger X, you do offer products here. So all of our listeners here in the U.S., they can come to Ledger X and trade, correct?
Yes, correct. We're open to all U.S. customers. And as you said, I think many people go overseas because of the regulatory environment, but we spent the many years to invest in getting the appropriate licenses. Our customers now don't have to worry about that. That was just work and pain that we had to go through. But now that we have it, it creates a platform where any kind of customer can come directly to us. It's a really clean model. And we take care of all of the regulatory issues like reporting and things like that. So customers can really just focus on getting their collateral to the platform and putting the trades on that they want to put on.
Well, you come from the trading side of options, so you know how difficult it is to find and provide and indeed to source liquidity. Now you're on the other side of that fence. You're trying to build up and provide liquidity in a lot of these products. You mentioned 100,000 strike calls. I have to imagine those are pretty thin at the moment. But walk us through what it's been like to try to grow and build liquidity on the options side over there at LedgerX. You know, how are you finding the market makers? What sort of response have you been getting from the community so far?
Well, I think it's a lot different than coming from the developed space, because I think if you're in the equity options market, you're trying to compete with other exchanges that are trying to steal market makers from other exchanges. And I think for us, the reason that we have market makers and liquidity is because the opportunity speaks for itself. You know, it is a new and nascent market. The options side provides a lot of opportunity to traders from the traditional space, as well as companies in the Bitcoin space that want to use products to hedge their risk, and then all the way to the retail investor that might just want to earn some income on their long Bitcoin through callover rights. So I think we're in the current state where really the opportunity from the product speaks for itself. And so it's not kind of the equities markets where people are trying to shave off these microseconds and compete on fractions of a penny in terms of fees and things like that.
No, we haven't reached that point yet, thankfully. I think there's a nice happy medium between where crypto is now and where the equities and options markets are now, where people can live and be happy and they're not racing to zero and spending hundreds of millions to shave off, like you said, milliseconds. A nice happy medium, and hopefully we could settle out somewhere in that medium. Now, obviously, you guys launched with a core focus around the institutional clientele with your LedgerX Pit. And you know, I've heard interesting and varying things from a lot of our guests over the course of this past year about what they're seeing and what they're hearing on the institutional side of the crypto space in terms of demand, particularly, you know, when we started getting into the teeth of the crypto winter there back in March. We were hearing interesting things about maybe some firms getting out of the space, or maybe saying one thing publicly, how they weren't interested in crypto, but behind the scenes were still maybe staffing up. Obviously, the crypto worm really turned in the last couple of quarters, and now we've seen north of 10,000, back south of it a little bit again, but still well north of the 3,000 level we were threatening there for a while. I'm curious for you guys, what have you seen on the institutional demand side over the course of this past year? Maybe as we were starting to threaten that 3,000 to the downside, were things a little sparse from a demand side? And have you seen a corresponding uptick as we've seen this resurgence in crypto? How has that played out for you guys over the course of the past year?
We haven't really seen the institutional demand. So first, I think we should just, especially for the listeners, understand when LedgerX talks about institutional, what we're really referring to, which is a CFTC designation for basically individuals or companies that have more than 5 to 10 million in assets. And so we saw and still see a significant element of our customer base and significant demand there, from companies that are miners to trading shops to high net worth individuals. And so those all sort of fall into the quote unquote institutional umbrella. And I think a lot of those types of firms are very committed to Bitcoin. So we're not seeing the demand ebb and flow as much as it might seem. But where we came out is after being live for about a year, we launched October 2017. So about a year later, as we observed some of the trends, we didn't see the growth in the market being towards the larger institutions. You know, I think Bitcoin here, I mean, now we're, up at 8,400 or so, is still $150 billion market cap, which is really big to small funds. It's really big to individuals, but it's tiny to a place like Goldman Sachs. And so we didn't see the growth going in that direction just yet. And we saw it really going more towards the retail side, which is what, Bitcoin is about, getting it into the hands of as many people as possible. And once we had proven our products and our models to the regulators, we felt comfortable, and they felt comfortable with us putting it in the hands of retail.
So let's get to that then. Omni, of course, is your recently announced, recently launched platform, specifically trying to take some of that LedgerX Pit functionality for the big boys, the institutional boys, and kind of winnow it down a little bit for the retail clientele. So obviously it's still early days, but how is it going, and what is the response you're seeing from Omni so far?
It's been fantastic. Honestly, it's far exceeded our expectations. And we, we only quote unquote soft launched Omni back in August, and the reception has been really great. I think it's really proved the products, and that there's a real need for a lot of the products that we have listed and launched. And we've gotten great feedback from customers, and just observing the flow, I think it's exactly what we wanted to accomplish with Omni, which is, we wanted more people to be more involved in Bitcoin in a variety of ways. And so we're seeing a lot of different types of behavior. Some individuals and, you know, retail investors who are using the platform just to get long exposure to Bitcoin, and some who are using it, as I mentioned before, where they have Bitcoin and they want to use options to overlay strategies on top of it. And so it's been a really great response. And I think it, for us, it's been very validating in terms of the approach that, you know, we took really a year, it was a year in the making, a year ago, to go down this path of getting options, physically settled options, into the hands of as many people as possible.
And would you say that's the primary use case you're seeing so far? It's speculation to the upside and also some dabbling and overriding as well?
Definitely, definitely overriding. I would say the way that we kind of think about it is, because we're a clearinghouse, and, you know, clearing is the non-sexy side of things, but it's very important. That's what allows us to guarantee all the trades. I think the biggest thing we're seeing is a lot of people who, you know, send us 1-2 Bitcoin, and then they use that for subsequent trading. And I think that's a really cool use case of Bitcoin, which is that it's super easy for, you know, a retail investor to just send Bitcoin to Ledger X 24/7, 365. They can sell the Bitcoin and then use dollars to purchase upside call options, which we see, and then they can do overwrites, as we talked about. So there's a whole wide range of things that they can do by just sending us Bitcoin. And so I think that's what we see overarching. And then probably if you look in terms of the trends, we are seeing more trading in the higher strikes further out. So this could be because we're approaching the end of the year and people aren't seeing a lot of 2019 catalysts, or could it be because of the nature of the retail investor? But we're definitely seeing more trading in the, you know, 25,000, 50,000, 100,000 strikes.
Now that you have a retail-oriented platform, you're fighting now and competing in those very blood-red retail waters out there on the brokerage side, where people, especially on the options side, they're pretty demanding when it comes to what they want from a platform, from tools. You need to provide them, you know, SKUs now, analytics, all sorts of things they want, all the bells and whistles they want on their platform. You also have to deal with all the customer management, customer experience side of the space, and calling up saying, why am I not filled, and all the fun things that go into a platform for the active bleeding edge of the retail side. So what's that experience been like for you guys now, dealing with all those additional demands of this portion of the market?
I think one of the biggest advantages that we have is that we are vertically integrated. So LedgerX, everybody just deals directly with LedgerX. They don't go through the traditional brokers, which means they sign up with LedgerX, they get an account with LedgerX, they log on to our web trading interface, they trade on the exchange, it clears immediately with LedgerX, and then we do all of the reporting. And so, one, that provides a really seamless experience to customers. But two, it allows us to be extremely nimble when it comes to responding to what customers want to see, responding to feature requests. You know, we can move very quickly. And so I think it's been really great for us to get the product into the hands of as many people as possible and see what they want, see how they're using it, and be able to adapt and just improve the product almost relentlessly. And so it's very different from the traditional world, where I think you have, you know, one company that controls the broker side, and then you have an ISV, and then you have the exchange, and then you have a different clearinghouse, and it's impossible to move quickly to get all those pieces to work together. We don't have that issue. And so for us, it's been really rewarding to see us take customer feedback and incorporate it into what's just becoming a better and better product every day.
Well, you're right. You know, that is one of the challenges, but also the opportunities of the crypto side of the space. You know, in traditional finance, you know, we don't see firms like in our space, the CME or the CBO. They're exchanges, and they're primarily out there building pools of liquidity in their products. They're not also out there doing the front end customer acquisition and providing, you know, all the different other bells and whistles. That's someone else's job. They only focus on their bucket. You guys have to wear all of those hats. So that's a challenge, but also it's a bit of an opportunity as well, because you could put them all in effectively one vertical integration and have them have that one experience. So it's interesting you view that as an opportunity, because I've heard some other firms kind of bemoan that, saying, oh, we have to do so much. But you guys sound like you view that more as an opportunity for you guys.
Yeah, absolutely. I think going into it, I could see why some people would, you know, be remiss to take that approach, because it does sound like doing a lot. But it's really just that initial, you know, investment. And then after that, what you find is you don't have to depend on other companies and other vendors when you want to change something, when you want to improve something, when you want to roll out a feature, and even just when you want to look at analytics of, you know, what people are clicking on, what they seem to like and not like. And so all of that, it's just a much richer experience. And I think I wouldn't say that we were so smart where we thought about this years ago. It was more that we were forced into it because at the time we were so early in Bitcoin that none of the traditional financial players would partner with us. And so we were forced to do all of the elements ourselves. And only after being forced to do it and spending years doing it that way have we really seen how lucky we were that we were forced into it, because it's allowed us to be a lot more, just a lot more adaptive and nimble than we could be otherwise.
That's true. There really was no one else to do it back a few years ago. So you had no choice. If you wanted to play in this space, you had to be both broker and exchange and pretty much everything else all at the same time. Well, speaking of brokers, you guys were pretty early adopters of this zero commission model. The entirety, it seems like, of the rest of the retail brokerage space, or your Schwabs, your TDs, your Fidelities, pretty much everybody else has jumped on that bandwagon now. Does that excite you? Does that maybe prove that you guys were in the right space to begin with? What are your thoughts of the rest of the retail brokerage space jumping on the zero commission bandwagon?
Well, I kind of view them as they're sort of coming at it from a different point of view. You know, the LedgerX approach is that we want very fair, transparent fees. You know, and we've always taken the view that the professionals are always going to price in the fees. And that's where we got to inverting the maker-taker model. I think the equity options market with the, the brokerage model and the fee structures there, you know, I won't get into it too much, but I think there are elements like payment for order flow that I just personally don't necessarily agree with. And so our goal with our fee structure has always been to just be clear and transparent and, and not, if you're going to pay a fee, you're paying a fee, and have the professionals are going to price it in anyway. So that's really where we came at it from, the maker taker approach. But I view that as separate from what everything that's going on with the Schwab, Robinhood retail brokerage side.
So you guys aren't directly selling your flow then?
Correct. We don't sell our flow because we don't have anyone to sell it to, because we just everybody just comes, they put their orders directly on our order book, and then they can interact with everybody else. We don't sell flow at all.
That is a challenge, right, in the crypto space. There aren't the usual players, if you even wanted to sell that flow too. Well, I'd be remiss if we didn't talk about all the interesting things that have been going on in your neck of the woods over the past couple of months. There's been no shortage of headlines in and around LedgerX. And we talked about, obviously, the options very near and dear to the hearts of a lot of our listeners here on this network, but also the futures are a big active part of the space. CME has been growing that space. We've seen launches now on the physically settled side from Bakkt. And of course, you guys had products launched. It was interesting. You had them launched in that space, and then you had to kind of dial that back a little bit, and the CFTC said effectively they weren't approved. Walk us through what happened there with the futures and what the status of that is now.
Yeah, it was. So we never launched futures. It's it really just stems from this complexity in the CFTC space, where there are very different regulations for swaps and futures. So we received a license in June, the DCM license, and the DCM license allows us to open up to retail, and two, it allows futures. And so because our clearing license hadn't been amended to clear for futures, what we did is we launched our DCM to retail with swaps. And I think there was it got picked up because it's not common that you list swaps on a DCM, but it is well within the regulations. And so I think it got picked up as launching futures, whereas really the story that we wanted, and the story that we still want out, is that we opened up to retail by launching that exchange. So it was all just, it really just stemmed from that that distinction. But the main thing is that we got the license for retail, and we opened that up. We launched it about a month after we received it. So we're currently just swaps and options on our DCM, and we're waiting an amendment to our clearing license that allows us to clear futures. Currently, our clearing license, as it's written, only allows us to clear swaps, which was just because initially, we only intended to do swaps, but we made the change about a couple of years later to go down this path.
Of course, physically settled futures seem to be all the rage these days. A lot of people have been talking about them. Bakkt obviously launched them a few weeks ago. Not too grand reception, at least from the marketplace. We've seen other players talking about physically settled. That seems to be the direction that a lot of the industry on the derivative side is moving for a lot of different reasons. It makes things a lot easier for a lot of offsetting positions, for things like overwrites you were talking about earlier. Certainly a lot easier to have a physically settled type contract. Of course, as you mentioned, your launch was a little bit delayed. Your CEO and of your husband has been somewhat outspoken on that front, looking at what he termed, I believe, a personal animus from a previous CFTC commissioner against what you guys were doing, also maybe implying that the CFTC was a little bit biased in favor of a large player like ICE, who's already established in the space and now getting into the crypto side versus a smaller new player like you guys. Is that still your position? Do you still feel that the CFTC has a bit of an axe to grind against Ledger X? And if so, how do you guys proceed from here?
Well, look, I'll say, you know, overall, I think we've been really happy with our experiences with the CFTC. And as for certain things that, you know, may have happened in the past, I will leave that to him to speak about, so you can have him on your show another time to talk about that.
Wise woman not speaking for her husband, not putting words in his mouth. That could cause problems
exactly.
Beyond just the scope of this program, I believe. We're looking forward to seeing how all that plays out. Obviously, we've been watching with great interest this entire side of the space, everything going on with the futures. CME now listing options on their futures, back listing their futures, and we don't know what else we're going to see from them. Obviously, you guys coming to play in this space, hopefully RSX at some point as well. So a lot of new players on this side of the space, which for our audience, for our listeners, more products, more choices, more options, pun intended, is always a good thing. And I want to hit on something else you guys have launched, which is certainly interesting for our audience, which is your LXVX, aka what you've termed it effectively, the Bitcoin VIX. Walk us through why you decided to launch this and what's the response been to this so far?
Well, yeah, as I mentioned, I traded the VIX at Goldman, and it's just emblematic of what one of the things that's great about options is just how rich the data is that's incorporated in them. And so, you know, we found that with having Bitcoin options on our platform and having a platform with price discovery, that we could offer out information to people that would be helpful to them regarding what the market is pricing in for Bitcoin volatility. You know, whether it's because there are upcoming ETF decisions, whether it's the halving that's coming up next year. You know, we thought that it's really rich, important data. And, what I find most interesting about it is that it's not just our options traders who use it. You know, a lot of times we have people who are just trading Bitcoin spot, who are just interested in what the volatility environment is looking like over the next couple months, or people who are running businesses who are trying to evaluate what kinds of catalysts are being priced in and how much they could expect Bitcoin to move, or things like Bitcoin miners. So we've been really happy with how we've been able to provide that that rich data to customers in the form of really just what's based on implied volatilities. You know, the methodology isn't the same as the VIX, but I think the idea is, you know, hey, how can we take this options data, a wide range of options data, and create a benchmark that people can start using to understand what kind of volatility is being priced into the Bitcoin market.
Well, it certainly is exciting for our audience. Obviously, we speak a lot on the volatility side, including every week on our Volatility Views program with all things VIX and spikes and VXX and all that fun stuff. So having a Bitcoin quote-unquote fear index is always a fun thing. By the way, just as a fun aside, I'm curious. You guys called it the Bitcoin fear index when you launched. Did you get any calls from the SIBO maybe saying, hey, you're stepping on our toes? Or were they okay with that moniker?
No, we haven't gotten any, so they must be okay with it.
I guess so. Either that, or maybe they're going to hear this and you're going to get a call. So maybe maybe I threw you under the bus there. But we like to see more products in that volatility space. And hopefully we'll see more going forward. Well, we talked about a lot of interesting things here over the course of this past, about 30-odd minutes. Juthika, we talked about the options you guys have listed. We talked about some of the other products you have, what's coming up, hopefully, in the future with the futures, talking about your institutional and indeed your new retail offering, Omni. You guys even have a podcast. You guys are competing with me here, Juthika. Should I be offended by that?
No, don't worry. Ours is a LedgerX-focused podcast. I'm just meeting the LedgerX team. We probably don't go nearly into as much options detail as you do.
Okay, so we're safe at least for another couple of weeks here. Well, we had a pretty far-reaching conversation, but that said, Juthika, if there's anything you forgot to mention, or maybe you want to leave our audience with a little bit of a hint, a little bit of a tease about what's to come from LedgerX in the coming months, now is the time. The floor is yours.
Well, you know, as I mentioned, the halving is expected in May of next year, and so I think you'll see some LedgerX products that will allow people to hedge and speculate around that.
Great. Well, we're looking forward to that. A lot of people are paying close attention to that. And of course, Jyothika, if listeners want to learn more, maybe they want to kick the tires for themselves, maybe they want to try Omni for themselves, where should they go? What should they do?
LedgerX.com. They can sign up for Omni there, see the LXVX. And if anyone wants to reach out to me, I'm on Twitter. It's my handle, my first name, Jyothika. So feel free to reach out to me there as well.
Jyothika is J-U-T-H-I-C-A, listeners, if you're looking to find her on Twitter. Well, Jyothika, I'm glad we can get you on and hear some more about what's going on in the world of LedgerX. And we'll look forward to seeing how Omni and LXVX and the futures and all these other initiatives, how they unfold in the crypto marketplace in the coming months.
Great. Thank you so much for having me.
Well, thank you. And thank you for listening. But we're not done yet. Don't worry. We have to keep on rolling, listeners, into our next segment. It is time to delve into the Bitcoin breakdown.
It's time to explore the latest trending activity, trends, and developments across the world's leading crypto market. It's time for the Bitcoin Breakdown.
All right, everybody. Time for the Bitcoin Breakdown, the portion of the show where we break down what the heck has been trading since the last time we all gathered here together on the program. And quite a bit. Not quite the extensive move we saw in previous weeks, but a decent little dalliance, shall we say, to the upside before things started to turn again midweek. As it often is these days, we saw a lot of the activity coming right after our show. Let's just start from the top there. We're looking here coming into showtime now compared to last show. Not a huge swing. We're talking it's about 60-odd handles to the north from where we were this time last week. So net on the week, not a huge move. But intra-week, we had a decent little blip. We saw the high of the week coming a few days after showtime last week on the 10th, right around 87.30 or so to the upside. Saw a nice sharp upswing. Didn't last too long, though. And actually, we saw the low of the week coming right before that. So we had, of course, the show last week. And then right after that, we saw it trending lower. 81.23 was the low of the week. Then on the 10th, hitting 87.30. So a nice roughly 600-handle swing over the course of that period. Then it kind of came off again to settle out back where we are right now. A little bit of topsy-turviness means vol up a little bit out there. Not a ton, but up a little bit. It was about 54% last week. The 1 month realized now it's up to about 60%. So ticking up a wee bit, not a ton. Also not a ton on the volume side. We're looking over there on Deribit this past week. Pretty light week. We like to use that barometer of about 30 million as terms of whether the day was active or not. And only one day crossed that threshold last week. That was on the 8th with about 34 million. Pretty much every other day of the week was below that 30 million level. In terms of where the trades were, what there was to parse last week, there wasn't a ton. Looking at a couple of size trades that came across our radar, the biggest trade we saw in the week on Deribit, just in terms of net number of contracts, looks like someone hedging a little bit to the downside, buying about 300 of the March 4,000 puts, doing that when Bitcoin was at about 8,200 or so. And then also saw someone selling a little bit of upside. So different day, not quite the same trade, not legging into a call or anything, doing about 160-odd of the 9,500 calls in October, overriding those maybe for a little bit of income there to the upside. But that was kind of it for the size trades of the week. Not a lot to really sink our teeth into, even though we had a decent swing in the middle of the week there. Vol term structure, relatively similar to last show, a little bit steeper than what we saw this time last week. More of a steeper slope, but pretty much the same shape, starting in the contract expiring this week and just heading up north from there. Actually had a 55 and implied around that level, and then heading up sharply from there. You get out to March of next year at about an 80, so a pretty sharp slope there in terms of vol term structure. Looking at the call to put, pretty close to what it was last week as well. We were at a 57 last week, this week 54, so pretty close to 50-50 calls versus puts. No real size bias one way or the other. Calls still in charge, but only slightly, so not a huge bias out there. In terms of open interest, we did see a little bit of a jump out there. It was 371 million on our last show. Now it's up to about 409 million. So looking pretty strong. Still pretty far short of that max level it hit back earlier in the year, about 658 million in terms of OI. So some stuff has come off the board, but it continues to tick up week over week. Where things aren't ticking up right now are over there on the Bitcoin futures over there on CME. I think a quiet day is overselling it. There's nothing really going on out there today. Not even 1,000 contracts on the tape coming into showtime. A decently active week, though. So you take today out of the equation. Friday, we saw about 4,200 contracts. Thursday, about 3,000. Wednesday, 5,200. Tuesday, a little bit shy, about 2,500. And Monday was the big day, 6,200 contracts on the tape there. So a decent week volume-wise, even though today, not a lot really going on. That's pretty much the same for the broad markets as well today. Kind of a quiet day as the market's digesting what the heck's going on out there with the trade war and also how a lot of people are off here for the Columbus/Indigenous Peoples Day holiday here in the U.S. So all that combining for heck of a lot of nothing for the most part when it comes to a lot of the markets. Let's see if altcoin can redeem us as we head on into the altcoin universe.
It's time to move beyond Bitcoin and find out what's moving the rest of the crypto marketplace. It's time to boldly venture into the altcoin universe.
All right, everybody. It's time for the altcoin universe. Let's see what's popping off in everything that isn't Bitcoin, except for this at the top here, where we look at how the market cap is shaping up for this week. Same standard caveat as always. Take the overall market cap numbers with a grain of salt, maybe a hefty grain of salt. But the percentages, I think, are at least in the ballpark of reliable. Number one, of course, obviously Bitcoin, about $150 billion or so out there. Number two, we got ETH at about $20 billion. That puts it at about 13.5% overall market cap. Number three, good old XRP, a little bit north of $11.5 billion. That puts it at about 7.75% on the market cap side. Bitcoin Cash, a little bit north of $4 billion, puts it at about 2.75%. Litecoin, number five, with about $3.5 billion. That puts it at about 2.4%. Let's throw in a little EOS, too, because I know you guys like yourselves some EOS out there. That's actually technically outside the top five, but if we knock Bitcoin out of there, we focus totally on the altcoin, then it is in the top five. That puts it at a little bit north of 2%, 2.15% at about $3.25 billion overall. Kind of an interesting week for the altcoin, kind of a bit of a mixed week, really, when you start looking at the major coins here. Let's start with ETH. ETH up a little bit, not a huge move, but five handles. The bulls out there will take what they can get. Coming into showtime here, we saw ETH at about 186 and change, and it's pretty much still there towards the latter portion. So right about 186 exactly. That puts it up about five handles from where it was, four and change from this time last week. Our old friend XRP continuing to get a little bit of love here this week coming into showtime. It's up almost another 2 cents, so threatening. Yeah, not quite 30, 29 and change level, but still, it's getting back up there again, clawing, fighting its way ever so firm. Let's check really quickly and see how high our friend XRP got over the course of the week. Nah, never really quite. It's at the high of the week right now, so it never really quite threatened 30, much beyond where it is. Not even 29 and a quarter, really, so not quite threatening 30. But also off of its lows of 26.60 earlier this week. So XRP bulls out there, I think, will take what they can get here. Looking over here, Litecoin also off, but off small from this time last week. Off about 1.5 handles. That puts it at a little bit shy of 57, about 56 and change over here on the show. And Bitcoin Cash, that's down, probably point-wise at least, it's the leader of the week, down about 9 handles from where it was last week. Last week, we were at about a 236 and at about a 227 coming into the latter portion of the show here. Interesting stuff. Of course, it's been kind of a rocky, turbulent week here in the altcoin space. There's been a lot of drama. It's been pretty much endless drama ever since Facebook announced Libra. Pretty much anything Facebook announces, it's endless drama. And Libra was no different. Of course, a lot of congressmen and women not exactly taking a shine to all things Libra. A lot of other players in the space not exactly taking a shine to it. Now we're seeing some pretty substantial partners dropping out of the Libra initiative. That includes Visa and MasterCard, where, you know, if you want to be on the payment side of the space, you might want to have one of those guys on board, just maybe. And both of them dropping out. eBay dropping out as well. Even Stripe, even the startups. They want nothing to do with it. PayPal having switched course as well. So this is a pretty extensive list of major partners that they were touting early on who are now no longer in the mix. It's clearly not done. Facebook hasn't given up on it, but it's going to be a much tougher road now without a lot of these players involved. And on top of this, there's the continuing attacks from D.C., This has become a bit of a populist red meat issue. A lot of people can sink their teeth into. Even other major tech CEOs have come across and said they're not really comfortable having or making a currency. They don't want to be in that game. And so a lot of people are already concerned with Facebook over their privacy issues. Now the notion of trusting a currency to them, not exactly going over well. So this initiative has been pushing, fighting against the wind for quite some time. And those headwinds seem to be growing, not shrinking. So I guess all those out there who thought or perhaps hoped that we would be chatting about Libra by this time with some trading volume and everything else and what's going on in that space, not so much, at least not for the foreseeable future. A few more headwinds they have to overcome before all is said and done. And unfortunately, that music means we're done here on the program. I want to thank Juthika for joining us from Ledger X. You know, a lot going on in their neck of the woods right now. I'm glad they were able to come and shed some light on all of that. So all of you have been asking us about options. Can you trade them here as a U.S. domiciled, registered, approved individual or as an institution? Ledger X is a place you can go. They have the swaps as well. Some, hopefully, some date in the future. We'll see the futures as well. Obviously, a lot still to be unpacked there. I think she wisely avoided talking about that one. Let her husband handle that one. He's been the one, I think, commenting on a lot of that as well. I'll have to get him on the get his side of the story as well. But obviously more to come over there from Ledger X in the coming weeks. In the meantime, of course, if you like Vol and all those other types of things, you know, a lot of our audience does. So you can sink your teeth into LXVX, get a little bit of the old Bitcoin Fear Index quote going over there as well. And I want to thank all of you out there for downloading, streaming, subscribing. Keep those questions coming. We'll get to more of them next week. And we'll see you back here next week for more of the Crypto Rundown.
You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at mixlr.com/options-insider. That's mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at twitter.com/options, stocktwits.com/options, facebook.com/theoptionsinsider, or via questions@theoptionsinsider.com. The Options Insider Radio Network is sponsored by Fidelity Investments. Fidelity's Option Trade Builder tool can help you confidently build an options trade in three simple steps. Just choose a strategy, select a contract, and then review the benefits and risks of the trade. Learn more about Option Trade Builder at fidelity.com/options. Options trading entails significant risk and is not appropriate for all investors. Certain complex option strategies carry additional risk. Before trading options, contact Fidelity Investments by calling 800-544-5115 to receive a copy of the characteristics and risks of standardized options. Fidelity Brokerage Services, LLC, member NYSE, SIPC.